everyone, welcome to Botany Insider, and in this lecture we will be discussing about some of the most important topics related to the unit 9, that is diversity of life forms. We won't be going into the complete depth of this unit, but some of the important topics would be discussed that are very important from the exam point of view. So talking about the unit, the first most important thing that we need to understand while studying this unit is that what is evolution. So evolution in simple terms can be called as a change. And what type of change it is? It is a heritable change. That is, it passes on from one generation on to the next generation. So we can say that evolution is the change in the heritable characteristics of the biological population over the successive generations. In simple word, it means that when there occurs changes in one population and those changes are heritable, or those changes could be transferred to the next upcoming generation of the previous generation, this type of change is known as evolution. And these characteristics are the expression of the genes that are passed on from the parents to the offspring during the reproduction. That is, when the parents reproduce together in order to form an offspring. So these changes are produced, and these changes are a result of the expression of the genes. And these genes are the genetic material that are transported from the parents to the offsprings. So let's move forward and understand about the hierarchical division or the hierarchical classification. You need not to go into the depth of each of the subtypes. Just remember this order, because many questions have been asked from this concept itself. So at the top level we have the kingdom, and as we move down, so kingdom is a more general form of division of a particular group of organisms. And as we move down in the hierarchical concept, the final and the most specific type of division is the species. So from the kingdom, we move on to the phylum, then we have the class, then we have the order, then we have family, and then we have genus, and finally the species. So when we write down the scientific name of any organism, we usually represent it by the name of the genus and the species. For example, talking about the humans, they are known as Homo sapiens. So Homo is the genus that we belong to, and sapiens is the species that we humans belong to. So this is the scientific name of how the naming is done. The initial or the formal name is of the genus, and the final name is on the species. So just remember that initially we have the kingdom, then we have phylum, class, order, family, genus, and the species. You can remember the initial letters of each of them and make a mnemonics out of it in order to remember it in the examination. So talking about the evolutionary systematics now. So as we have understood that what is evolution, so in the same line, evolutionary systematics, as the word suggests, it is the evolution of the classification of the organisms on the basis of their evolution in terms of the history and their natural ability. So evolutionary systematics in simple word means that when we are actually studying about the classification of organism, and that classification is mainly based upon the evolution. And the evolution, on a more specific note, is based upon their previous history and their natural ability that they were capable of in the initial times of the history. So talking about the evolutionary tree, so when we understand about the evolutionary systematics, we need to understand that what is evolutionary tree, because when we are understanding that what is evolutionary systematics, so evolutionary trees are actually the representation of the systematics, or they are the representation of the actual study that we are dealing with. So evolutionary trees can also be given the name of the phylogeny, and in a specific term they usually show the evolution over the course of time. They represent the evolutionary relationship among a set of organisms. That is, consider we have few organisms, and if we represent their classification on the basis of their phylogeny or the evolutionary tree, then at the end of this drawing or at the end of this representation, we would be able to represent their evolutionary relationship among this set of organisms. So when we represent these organisms on an evolutionary tree or a phylogeny, first thing we need to understand is a taxa. So taxa in biology means a taxa is a group of one or more population of an organism or the organism seen by the taxonomist to form a unit. And a taxon is usually known by a particular name or given a particular ranking. What do we mean by this? As we have just studied that we have this complete hierarchy, so each of this hierarchy or each of this group of organism represents a particular taxa. A taxa could be a very specific also, as in case of the species. In this also we are representing a group of organism, and a taxa could also represent a kingdom if we are talking about that particular organism, or if we are talking about that particular group in a more general sense. So taxa in very simple terms means that it is a particular name or a particular ranking that is given to a group of organisms. So let's understand about a simple phylogeny or an evolutionary tree. So the first and the most important point to remember is that we need to understand the important components of this tree, and they are the root, branches, time and the node concept. So talking about the root, so root represents the common ancestor of the species that we are representing, and here we have species 1, 2 and species 3. And whenever we encounter any node where we can see a bifurcation in the complete tree, that particular interjunction is known as the node, which represents a common ancestor of the two species that are represented on the top of the same. So here we have species 1 and species 2 sharing the common ancestor because they are represented at a common node, and because species 3 does not follow or does not share any common ancestor with the species 1 and species 2 in more particular sense, hence it is given out in a, or hence it is represented by a branch. Next important point to remember is the time factor, that is the length of these branches, the length of these lines actually represent the time at which they have evolved from the previous or the another species. So now let's understand about the two main processes of evolution. So mainly we have two main processes. First one is the anagenesis and the second one is the cladogenesis. So talking about anagenesis, so in anagenesis we have the change in the gene frequency, and it is usually in the entire population, and also here the speciation occurs without splitting. And what is speciation? We would be understanding about this in detail in separate video, but in simple word, speciation means formation of a new species from the existing species. So in anagenesis, what we have is that the initial population changes into another type of population with course of time, and this leads to the speciation, or this leads to a different type of population being created. And because there occurs no splitting of the existing population, hence it is given the name of anagenesis. Talking about cladogenesis, so in cladogenesis we have the population get splitted out, and in this the speciation occurs with splitting. And when we learn about the cladogenesis, and as a result of cladogenesis there are cladograms formed. They are also a type of the phylogenetic tree that we are focusing upon, about which we would be understanding in the further slides. So cladogenesis could be represented as consider this is the population that we are talking about. It's split it out into two groups of population, and with course of time it again split it and hence leads to the formation of a different type of population or a different type of species. Hence we could say that in cladogenesis we have the speciation with splitting, and in anagenesis there is speciation without splitting. Make sure you remember this important difference between the two processes, as it have been asked previously in the CSIR net. So talking about the cladograms that are formed as a result of the cladogenesis, so these are the typical cladograms that we need to focus upon. Let's understand about it. So before understanding the types of cladogram, let us understand about that what a typical cladogram looks like. So initially we have the root node, where we have the common ancestors of all the groups that we are representing in that particular cladogram. And as there occurs splitting, because we have studied that in cladogenesis we have the population split out, hence there occurs the splitting out of the population, and there occurs formation of different groups of the population. One group splitted out and evolved into a taxon C, and the other group that splitted out again diversified into two more type of groups, that is taxon A and taxon B. And what is a taxon? We have already discussed. So taxon basically means a group. So initially we had a larger group, and this larger group splitted out into two subgroups, first turned into a taxon C, and the other group again splitted out and formed two more groups, that is taxon A and taxon B. And as you can see, there occurs splitting of the population, hence it is a cladogram. And also initially we have the root node, where we have the common ancestors of all the three, and the second node where there occurs a splitting, it is the common ancestor of species A and species B, or we can also call it as taxon A and taxon B. Next important point to remember is that because taxon A and taxon B arised, or they evolved from a common ancestors, hence they are given the name of sister groups. And because the taxon C is less closely related to taxon A and B as compared to both of them, hence C is the outgroup to A and B. Reason: taxon A and taxon B have a much closer relationship with each other, they are given the name of sister groups. And because taxon C is not much related to A and B, but they follow or they share a common ancestors, hence it is given the name of outgroup. And this outgroup is in relation to the taxon A and taxon B in particular. So I hope this is clear to you. So now let's understand about the monophyletic, the polyphyletic and the paraphyletic type of group. So in the initial case we have the monophyletic. So monophyletic in simple word represents a group and all of its ancestors. As you can see, the common ancestor for all of them is the B, and monophyletic represents all of its ancestors and also its subtype. None of the taxon of this particular common ancestor have been left out in this monophyletic type of group. And then we have polyphyletic. So polyphyletic group represents, or it consists of, the taxon that are not related to each other by the immediate ancestors. As you can see, E and G taxon does not have immediate ancestors, but their common ancestors is at a farther length. So polyphyletic represents the group or the taxon that do not have the immediate ancestors as the similar one. But in case of monophyletic, we have the common ancestors and all of its taxon in the same group. Talking about the paraphyletic, so paraphyletic represents the ancestor and few of its subtypes or few of its taxon, and not all of the subtypes or not all of its taxon are actually included in this particular type of group. So let's recall it once again. In monophyletic, we have the ancestor and all of its taxon in the similar group. In polyphyletic, the two organisms or the two groups does not share the immediate common ancestors. And in paraphyletic, we have the common ancestor and few of its taxon. As you can see, A have both I and B as its taxon, but B is not included, only I and its subtypes are included, hence it is the paraphyletic type of the group. Make sure you remember each one of them, because many questions have been asked and this is one of the most frequently repeated topic of CSIR UGC NET. So let's move forward and understand about few of the terms of cladistics. So we have five main terms of cladistics. The first one is synapomorphy, then we have autapomorphy, homoplasy, apomorphy and the synplesiomorphy. So talking about the synapomorphy, so synapomorphy usually means the character in the recent common ancestor and all of its descendants. So synapomorphy represents this group in which we have the character in the ancestor and all of its descendants. Talking about autapomorphy, so autapomorphy represents a unique and a distinctive character which is found in any one or any specific type of the descendants only and not in any other common ancestors. Talking about the homoplasy, so homoplasy is the characters in set of species but never in the ancestors. That is, you can see a different type of character being seen in this phylogenetic tree, but this character was not seen in any other ancestors before time. Talking about apomorphy, so apomorphy means the character in the new descendants that are not even present in the recent ancestors, and this makes a new clade. As you can see that in case of apomorphy, we have the characters in only the new descendants and it was not present in the recent ancestors. Talking about synplesiomorphy, so synplesiomorphy is an ancestral trait that is shared by two or more taxa. As you can see that this particular character is found in the ancestor and also two or more of the taxa represents the same ancestral trait. Make sure you remember each one of them. In synapomorphy, we have the characters in the descendant and the common ancestor. In autapomorphy, we have a unique and a distinctive character in only one of the descendants. Homoplasy represents character in a set of species. Difference between autapomorphy and homoplasy is, in autapomorphy, we have only a single type of the characters seen in a distinctive descendants. In homoplasy, we have the character in a set of species, but it was never in the ancestors. In apomorphy, we have the character in the new descendants, and in the synplesiomorphy, we can see the ancestral trait that is shared by two or more than two taxa. So this is all about the terms of the cladistics. So you can see that one question have also been asked related to the same. So these are the figures that are given, as we have just discussed about this figure, and applying the same knowledge in this question, we could easily solve this question and fetch out 4 golden marks. So as we have discussed, the first one represents the synapomorphy, as the new or the derived character is in the descendants and the recent ancestors. Second, we have the homoplasy. In the second one, we have the characters shown in the set of species, hence it is given the name of homoplasy. And in the third one, we have the autapomorphy, as it is a unique and a distinctive character seen in only one of the descendants. So following the rule or following the knowledge that we have just gained, D is the correct option. As you can see, this question is very easy, and very easily you can get four golden marks. So let's understand about the difference between the cladograms and the phylogenetic trees. So talking about the cladograms, they are a type of the phylogenetic trees, and in this we mainly represent the ancestral time that the two particular species or the two particular group of taxon that we are focusing upon. And also in this we mainly focus upon the ancestral and the shared characters. Talking about the phylogenetic trees, so cladograms are a subtype of the phylogenetic trees, but in phylogenetic tree we mainly focus upon the evolutionary relationship, and also the time scale representation is given the more priority. But in cladogram we mainly represent the ancestral and the shared characters. So the last point or the last important topic in this particular lecture is the principle of parsimony. So what this principle of parsimony says, in very simple terms we can say that principle of parsimony says that always choose something that have the simplest explanation. That is, if you want to explain something, that is, if I want to explain this particular formula or this particular question, so I should use or I should choose the simplest method, and also the method which requires the least amount of steps in order to explain or in order to solve this particular question. So principle of parsimony or the law of parsimony is the problem solving principle that entitles should not be multiplied without necessity or more simply. We can say that the simplest explanation is usually the right one. We can also call it as that one should always choose the simplest explanation and the one that requires the fewest steps giving the accurate results. As you just studied, just use the method or just use the application which requires the least steps, and second, which have the simplest explanation of the required method. So let's understand about the principle of parsimony by the help of this particular question. So we are given the distribution of the traits and also these cladograms, and we need to find out that based upon the trait distribution and the principle of the parsimony, we have to select the correct option. So let's read the question first. So as a biologist, you want to classify three taxa A, B and C. You have the information on the three traits P, Q and R. The traits are ancestral is counted as 0, and the traits that is derived is counted as 1. The distribution of the traits found in three taxa is given below. So this is the distribution of the traits, and based upon this they have also drawn the cladograms for the same. All we need to understand is that how to apply the principle of parsimony. So we have discussed that the principle of parsimony says that try to have the fewest steps possible in order to reach to the final goal, and in this particular scenario the final goal is to draw a cladogram. So let's count the number of steps and reach to the final answer. In the initial one we have 1, 2, 3, and 4. We have 4 steps. In the second one we have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 steps, and in the third one we have 1, 2, 3, and 4 steps. So depending upon the principle of parsimony, B cannot be the cladogram possible. So just eliminate wherever B is written. So we can eliminate option A and option B. So as you can see that we have in both option A and option C 4 steps possible. Now we need to find out that which cladogram is correct. According to principle of parsimony, both of the cladograms are correct, but depending upon the trait distribution we need to get to the final answer. So depending upon the trait distribution, let us analyze the first option. So initially we have the common trait found in both A and B is P. So A and B have a common trait of P, and as you can see that just this representation helps us to reach the correct answer, as A and B follow the same trait of P. But in cladogram C, we can see that P is represented in both of the branches, hence this is not a correct explanation. Hence, we could reach out to the final answer as that only cladogram A is possible based upon both the trait distribution and also based upon the principle of parsimony. All you need to do in these type of questions is just count the number of steps. In the first one, we have 1, 2, 3 and 4 steps. In the second one, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And in the third, 1, 2, 3 and 4. And when you eliminate any one of the option, go to the second step, and that is analyze the trait distribution. And talking about the trait distribution, when we analyze it based upon the table given, we could easily find out that A and B share the P trait and they are not different for each other. Hence, C cannot be the final answer. Hence, only cladogram A, that is option D, is the correct answer. So with this, we are done with the important topics of Unit 9 in complete detail. So I hope this video was helpful for you. So if you like this video, please do like, share it with your friends, and please subscribe to my channel. And I'll be coming up with more important topic videos as well. So thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you soon. Bye.